lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. Your name. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. Your name. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. Your name. Wonderful Savior. Wonderful Savior. Wonderful Savior. Jesus. Wonderful Savior. Wonderful Savior. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. Your name. We lift our hands in praise. Lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. Your name. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. Praise. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. Your name, Jesus. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. Your name, wonderful Savior. Savior, Jesus, wonderful Savior, Jesus, wonderful Savior, Jesus. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise. We lift our hands in praise.
Praise your name.
Savior, Lord forever, God Almighty, Jesus. Heaven's glory, eternity song. Heaven's glory, eternity song. Jesus, Jesus, we lift our hands and pray. We lift our hands and pray. God's mercy and His grace, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. God's mercy and His grace. Bore my sins away, washed me, made me holy. Bore my sins away, made me everything acceptable. Heaven's glory, eternity song. Oh, heaven's glory, eternity song. Wonderful Savior, holy and acceptable. Hallelujah. Jesus made me holy and acceptable. Jesus made me. Let heaven and earth now praise Him. Let the abiding place lift up their song. Let all the people of the Lord worship Him, and all who love His salvation say continually, the Lord be magnified. Woo! Jesus, Lord to me, Master, Savior, Prince of Peace, O ruler of my heart today, Jesus, Lord to me.
With us. revealed in us. Oh, how you are.
This new covenant.
Oh, yeah.
New covenant,
this new covenant.
goes.
My Jesus,
my Savior. Lord, there is none like you. Hallelujah. Lord, you're worthy. Manamosoko. Alabasete. Holy, holy, holy.
Heaven. Jesus is heaven. Jesus. Words cannot express what you've done for us, oh God. It's impossible to say the things that's in our heart to say, oh God. But we thank you, Lord Jesus, for this redemption, for this blood-washed, blood-bought state of being that we live in right now before you, holy and acceptable. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God.
Yeah, this is all. Thank you, Father.
I love church because church is heaven to me. It's going up to heaven. You know, we love our personal relationship with the Lord, but church is heaven. Father did something special when he sent the promise, when Jesus came, having finished the work that Father gave him to do, and he stood before the Father there that day with his own blood, with his now pierced hands, with a scourged back, with a brow-scarred face and forehead, and the gashes and the cuts that were so deep in his face, marred forever, always seen as a lamb that is slain, as a lamb slain, as one that had been sacrificed, filleted. And he stood there with his own blood, and it was all settled and it was all done, and eternal redemption had been paid. And Father purged with his own blood through Christ Jesus the heavenly things and the earthly things, everything. He poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost, the promise of the Father, and he begat a new day, the day of the new covenant that finds its whole central expression and meaning and value in the church. In the church. Somebody said, in my living room? No. In the local church, where elders and deacons have been put into place, and where Christ Jesus himself set in apostles, they can't be in your living room. He set in his place, prophets, hallelujah, pakotaramake, teachers, hallelujah, his holy, glorious church, the one who championed for us our salvation, who won for us. He won gifts. He won them. He won gifts for us. Hallelujah. And according to his own plan and according to his own will, he put in apostles and prophets and evangelists, pastors and teachers. And there's nothing, no gates of hell will prevail against the church. It does not matter to me what goes on around me peripherally, what men try to champion, what men try to do. What Jesus has done is settled forever. No man can overthrow it. It cannot be in any way stopped or pushed
down.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I pray in Jesus' name that you'll begin to make church what God has made it.
Come on.
The very revelation of his only begotten Son.
Yeah.
The riches of heaven. I pray in the name of Jesus, the church will become a place for you like never before.
Yeah.
Where it isn't about you, but it's about Christ Jesus. Where you'll crown him as your Savior. In crowning him as your Savior, you remove out of the equation, you remove out of your thoughts, out of the way, all the things, all the shame, all the guilt, all the condemnation, all the stuff that the powers of darkness would try to lay upon you. And you just see him. You look into the author and finisher of your faith. Begin to behold him who loved you so much. He who began a good work. Woohoo! He who began a good work is going to finish it. Hallelujah. The enemy of your soul does everything he can do to try to steal away the praise and the thanksgiving and the adoration and the outpouring of love and grace from heaven upon your life. If you will allow the Spirit of the Lord to simply reveal Jesus and glorify him in your life, you will have a continual outpouring of grace and mercy and goodness. You'll have a continual outpouring of heaven upon your life. And then you step into the church, the assembly. Something is supposed to go on in the church that we've not made room for, that we've not understood how to make room for. If church began to be so commercialized and so organized that really we left the description of Acts chapter 2.
Right.
We left the description of Acts chapter 19. We left the description of 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter 14. We left the glory of a realm where God's people are gathered together and saturated in such an outpouring of divine love. Hallelujah. If today we could be used by the Spirit of the Lord to bring you to a place of just yieldedness to the Holy Spirit, which comes by your willingness to accept everything that Jesus did for you at Calvary. And begin to be wrapped up in that bigger than anything else in your life. Well, what's going to happen? Change is going to take place. And you're going to begin to experience. The other day, she's not here right now to this morning's beer tonight, but she was telling me, she said, you know, Pastor, she said, I don't know, something happened. I just stepped in the meeting to something. She's a sweet, everybody knows Brittany. She's the sweetest, loving thing that you could possibly run into. She said, I stepped into a love that I didn't even know existed. She said, I started hugging people, and there was just a deep love and this deep affection. I said, that's heaven. That's heaven. That's just heaven. That's just heaven. And see, Jesus made a way that we might be able to escape the condemnation, the wrath. He made a way that we may escape death and hell. And anybody today here standing in this place should be willing to leave hell behind. And you must leave hell behind to go into heaven. You can't go into heaven and be in hell. You got to say bye to hell. Bye to the trouble, the sorrow, the suffering, the condemnation, the separation, the sense of sin. And just begin to embrace not what you've done for God, but what he did for you. Not how you love him, but how he loves you. Because this is first love. You know, I've heard it said that people talk more about Jesus in the first 5 months of their salvation than they do for the rest of their walk with God. That is just a terrible statistic that needs to be defeated by keeping the first love fire burning. Everybody say this with me. Say, it's not about me.
It's not about me.
It's about Jesus.
It's about Jesus.
And I'm going to spend the rest of my life.
I'm going to spend the rest of my life.
Crowning him.
Crowning him.
Savior. Hallelujah. Redeemer.
Redeemer.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. This is the worship. This is the worship. This is the power. This is the divine ability for you to escape every harassing, condemning thought. For you to escape every problem, every oppression, everything that's come against you, everything that's done you wrong, everything that has upset you, everything that has discouraged you. This is how you do it. You begin to worship him for all that he's done. You begin to make him your Savior, your Redeemer. You begin to make him Christ Jesus the Lord. Hallelujah. You begin to honor him. You begin to crown him with many crowns.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Hallelujah. Oh, for 1,000 tongues that I may sing of my Redeemer's love for me. Come shout a bit. Come worship the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Come bless his holy name.
Hallelujah.
Come bless his holy name. Come bless the one who's redeemed you with his blood, who's washed you whiter than snow, who set you up on high, who's given you an inheritance, who's given you a life that will not fade away. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to worship you.
All my soul
rejoice, take joy, my King. Father, I thank you for the power and the authority of the blood of Jesus Christ upon every soul and life in this place right now. Father, we thank you for the authority that we may take a hold of the lives of men and claim them from heaven and break off the yoke of sin and bondage and the yoke of everything that the demonic realm would try to impose upon them. We thank you, Lord, that you've given us the authority to destroy the works of the enemy. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that not one person will leave from this place with any kind of sickness or disease or sin or sorrow or discouragement in their life, but they would step in today into the realms of heaven, into the realms of the Holy Ghost, and not step out. Hallelujah. And I pray in Jesus' name that you guys understand just how simple it is. Somebody said to me, well, how do I know if I'm walking in the Spirit? Well, you're walking in heaven. Just check yourself. Does it feel like heaven?
Pretty simple.
Somebody said, well, what if it doesn't feel like heaven? Just begin to praise the name of Jesus. Don't begin to struggle and worry and strive and try to act like you're talking Papa into something, because you're not. He's trying to convince you. Just begin to worship him. Begin to rejoice in Christ your Savior. Hallelujah. Begin to be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself in psalm and hymn, spiritual psalm. Hallelujah. Patara Bahaya. Hallelujah. Listen, I'm telling you, if you could just hear me, just hear this one simple thing. You know, there's been much discussion on the weapons of our warfare, which is really the solution for us to be able to deal with everything Satan would try to throw at us. But Father showed us in the Old Testament one of the greatest weapons of our warfare. He showed us when they marched around the walls of Jericho. He showed us when Jehoshaphat led an army out. Hallelujah. Don't need no sword, don't need no bow, don't need no shield, don't need no weapon in the arms of men, don't need no special strategy, don't need no special anointing or education. All you gotta do is begin to praise Him. All you gotta do is begin to worship Him. All you gotta do is begin to thank Him for so great a salvation. Hallelujah. Without hesitation, begin to dance and praise Him. Woo-hoo! Now begin to rejoice in the Lord. Begin to lift up a song with thanksgiving. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Don't miss out on one day of heaven. Don't miss out on 1 second of heaven. When you were born in the Spirit, you were born into the realms of heaven. Don't miss out on 1 second of heaven again. Forget about all the rest of the stuff. You begin to seek first the kingdom of God. You begin to seek the realms of heaven, that which belongs to Christ Jesus and that which belongs to the realms of the Holy Ghost and the righteousness which He has given. Not by any works of righteousness which we have done. You begin to seek Him in this way. I'm going to tell you right now, it is the best occupation with the highest pay and the greatest benefits that exist. It is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, we're so blessed to have our dear friends, Joe and Becky here, and we need to get them out here more. I can't tell them every year, hey, you guys gotta, you need to come out every month, kind of thing. sometimes when you move it in that realm of the future, you speak in the tense of the present. But nonetheless, we are in great expectation of the things that Father is doing. I heard somebody, I was talking to a guy. It was just really very depressing. And he's like, all the men of God are dead and gone. You know, and it was just on and on. I'm just like, come on, people, listen, God, your friends, all the old guys may be dead and gone, but Father's not dead and gone.
No, He's not.
And God the Holy Ghost is not dead and gone.
No.
Jesus is just as much here as He's ever been. Give me a break. And so we're just in expectation of great things, and we want you to be in expectation of great things, because then that's how Father's going to be able to use you. I do not believe a single word that CNN says. I don't believe a single word that Fox News report or any of their answer. I don't believe a single thing that I say. If it's God's word, it's true. All the rest of it's suspect.
Yes.
All the rest of it is based upon my perception and your perception. Do you understand that? Your interpretation. But what happens if we just begin to find ourselves elated with what Father said in expectation of those things that He's described to do in our lives and amongst us? We, the people of a new race.
New race.
This is a new race. When God called Abraham out and separated him by a covenant, a new race was born. When God took Israel out of Egypt, that day a new nation was born. In the new covenant, a new race and a new nation, hallelujah, was born. Come on, people. Just get all the way over into heaven. Let's get all the way over into the things of the Spirit. And let's be who we are called to be.
Yes.
Let's be sons of God. Let's be the representatives of heaven. Let's be those who He's fully invested as heirs and co-inheritors. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, right now, look at me. Financial provision and favor.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, prosperity to you now. You know, is it Psalms 118? Send prosperity now, oh God.
That's
it's
right.
A desperate situation.
Send it now.
That's right. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, daughter of the Lord, servant of the Most High God, you have everything that you have need of He's providing for you out of his unsearchable riches, out of his riches in glory, out of the realms of all that he possesses. Don't you fret. Don't be afraid. Don't let fear enter your heart in Jesus' name. That goes for everybody else here too. Find yourself in a financial need. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Well, Joe, come.
Hallelujah. Y'all don't have to sit down yet. You know, whenever he was saying that all the fathers are dead and all this kind of, all the old guys, I looked at him, I said, then what are we? My daughter Allison, now she's grown, we have a new grandbaby, but she used to say chalk liver instead of chop liver. So what are we, chalk liver? No, man. What a joy to be here today. Come on, are you expecting? Hallelujah. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. Can we sing it? Sing it. Amazing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace. This verse, the Lord has promised good to me, his word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life. Chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing. And like a flood, and like a flood, his mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. God, we love you today. You see, grace is not license to do whatever you want to do. But grace is receiving what we don't deserve. No way to obtain it. Grab a hold of it without coming and humbling ourselves before Almighty God and acknowledging that Jesus is the only way. and laying down our life of sin and degradation, walking away from it, never to go back again, and humbly coming before the throne of grace and saying, Lord, I receive, as Pastor said a while ago, I receive everything you have for me. Lord, I'm not leaving until I get everything you have for me. And I'm going to position myself so that, Lord, you can pour into me. You can trust me. Lord, you can trust me. Can the Lord trust you? I think that's the biggest question. Lord, you can trust me. Not because of who I am, but because of who you are. Because I believe that you're everything. And I am nothing without you. Before we go anywhere else this morning, let's just take a moment, just close your eyes, and just, if you're here today and you were invited by a friend, or you're here today and you just got up and said, you know what, I got to get to church. Maybe you've never given your heart to Christ. You've never put your faith and trust in Jesus. Maybe you're here today and you'd say, Brother Joe, I'm just not sure where I stand with God. Or maybe you're here today and you'd say, Brother Joe, I know him, but I've allowed the cares of life. Stuff has happened in my life, and I want to come back to my first love. If you're in one of those three categories today, you're either lost, you've never given your heart to Christ, you've never prayed the prayer of salvation, you're just not sure, or as a believer, you've been away from the Lord and today you want to come back to your first love. If you're in one of those three categories, is there anyone like that here today and you just lift your hand and say, Brother Joe, would you pray for me? Is there anyone like that here today? Anyone? I know you're radical here in this place, an abiding place, but maybe there's someone who came today and you just don't know where you stand, but you'd say, Brother Joe, would you pray for me? Anyone? Anyone today like that? Maybe you're here today and you'd say, Brother Joe, as a believer, I'm struggling with some things. Maybe it's a habit. I don't know. Maybe it's something that's got a hold and or a sickness or something, and you just really need for the Lord to come and set you free. Release that chain of bondage from your life. If that's you, would you lift your hand and say, would you pray with me? If that's you, just come and meet me right here at the front of the auditorium very quickly. Before I preach, before I share another thing, just come and stand and lift your hands. I don't even have to know what it is, because the Lord does. Just lift your hands. Today is your day to go free. I break every stronghold, every lie of the enemy off of you today. Totally free. Totally free. Totally free. Never again. Never again. Fire, 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 fire. Fire! Totally free. Every stronghold, every attack has to go right now. The taste of it, whatever it is, it'll be bitter. Can't even look at it. Totally free. Totally free. Totally free. My chains are gone, I've been set free. Not another minute, His mercy reigns, unending love. Anyone else? Amazing grace. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior. My. We love you, Lord. I don't know about you, but he's been good to me. It's been like a dream, a good dream. Wake up beside the woman of my dreams. I get to be with people that love Jesus with all of their heart. We get to introduce people to the family of God. What a life. There's no other way to live. Just lift your hands and thank him one more time. It's like a flood. The flood of heaven in this place floods our soul with his goodness. Floods our soul with his light. Amazing grace. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a bird, his mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. Thank you, Lord. Well, hug the person on either side of you. Say, I'm so glad you're here. Wouldn't be near as much fun without you. And then you may be seated. Hey, I like this. This is cool. Lord, have mercy. This is an amazing place.
It is amazing.
Oh. Radical people come to this church.
It feels like you go to another nation.
You know what? That's the truth. You come to Abiding Place, you feel like you're in another country. No, I'm serious. You feel like you're in another country. We're in the country of San Diego today. Hallelujah. Well, you know, what do we say? No, just God is great. He's awesome, and we love your pastors very, very much, and they're amazing people. There's not another pair like them, okay?
Thank God.
Thank God, yeah. Nowhere on the planet. And you know what you do here on Sunday, you can't do everywhere. Do you know that? Please don't take this for granted. You don't get to do this everywhere you go. You know, just to sing the new song of the Lord and just go there and the people go with you. Yeah. Most places you begin to do that and they look at you like a calf looking at a new gate, you know. What is that? You know. What in the world is that? What are they saying? What are they saying? They're singing heaven's song. Sing with them. They don't have a clue, but anyway, the Lord is good. Oh, oh my gosh. Let me remind you. I'm not even going to try and teach because this man over here is an incredible mind and an incredible teacher. So I'm going to get real simple with you today. Is that all right? There is a push in the things of God. There really is. There's a rest, there's a peace, but there's a push. And how many of you know the enemy, he tries to take ground in our life. And there are ways that we push back. There are ways that we counteract that. There are things that we do in the life of a believer that breaks that attack of the enemy or what he tries to bring into our life. And I call it the push. And it's very simple. You've heard this 1,000 times, but I want to remind you. And you can take this and you can carry it with you. You can use it. This is the way my wife and I have lived for our entire married life since we stepped into the fullness of the Holy Spirit to walk in the ways of the Lord. There's a push. There really is. And the enemy, he tries to take ground, but he has no authority. The only authority that he has in our life is the authority that we give him. Okay? And he's a defeated foe. He's a defeated foe. At the cross, he was defeated. Okay? There are a lot of people talk about the enemy, talk about Satan, preach, sing about him. They even sing to him. Now, I'm serious. And I'd rather sing about Jesus. Okay? Because just at the mention of his name, the enemy has to flee. He hates that name. So if you want to start your day the right way, just start off by saying Jesus. Just start off by just mentioning his name. And so today I want to talk a little bit just simply about the push. It's an acronym for a word, and the letters of the word push are praise until something happens. Now, I know that's real deep. Praise until something happens. And the enemy, if he can just close your mouth, just shut you up for a while, then he's done a pretty good job of setting you back a long way. And so there are many things. We talked about it coming down the way today, praying in the Holy Ghost and talking and having a good time. But there are suddenlies in the Bible. And the Lord has had my wife and I on a journey this whole year on suddenlies. That the Lord said, I want you to expect for me to move in an instant, regularly. That any moment, anywhere, any place, you can have a suddenly. I mean, that's the way God works, and that's the way the Bible says in there in Genesis, and God said, light be. All he had to do was speak it. And the particles that were not even there began to come together. And this place was formed. The suddenlies of God. And so today and tonight, I'll continue on this tonight. We'll talk about the suddenlies, and I'll give some other examples of some suddenlies in our life. And so you don't want to miss tonight. We'll pray for everybody and have a great time. Lay hands on everyone that wants to be have hands laid upon them. But we'll continue with the suddenlies tonight. But I want to talk about the push this morning. And it has a suddenly contained in the midst of it. So if you have your Bible, look at Acts chapter 16 and look at verse 16 through 34. You know this story, like the back of your hand, Paul and Silas. And there were some things that had happened that landed them in the inner dungeon. Anybody ever been in the inner dungeon? I felt like I was there once or twice in my life. But really and truly, it was an opportunity for a suddenly of God. You have to understand something. Everything that happens in your life, God allows those things into your life for a purpose. He does. He allows them in your life for a purpose. And most of the time, that purpose is for you to see him. To see how big he is. And the Bible says here, and I'm just going to read it real quickly. And it came to pass, when they went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with the spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. This woman was very powerful, and she could tell the future and things like that. But it says, the same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show us unto us the way of salvation. And this they did for many days. They began to do this in mockery. But as she began to follow them, she began to see the power of God. And the day came that she made that statement, and I believe she made it out of a step and a statement of faith. And I believe that moment, that suddenly Paul and Silas saw it, and they took that opportunity to cast the devil out of her, and she became a Christian. And instantly the guys got mad because they lost their way of making a living. They lost their best convert. And so they got the magistrates and the people there to throw them in jail. And as we're reading along this passage, you know, all this good stuff. They're in the innermost prison in stocks and chains. And turn to your neighbor and say, and at midnight. I know we're in the middle of the day, but at midnight. Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly, turn to your neighbor and say, and suddenly. You know, suddenly it's like this. I'm talking about suddenly. The Bible says, and suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison awakened out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that all the prisoners had fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice saying, don't do any harm to yourself, we're all here. Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And suddenly Paul and Silas, they could have said, hey, don't worry about it, we're all here. But he said this, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. He took that opportunity to lead that man and his family to the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm telling you right now, you have no idea of the people around you that are living in a suddenly right now in the middle of their life, and they are so close and so ready to be born again. God is doing so many things. You have suddenlies that happen all the time. Provision that comes. A vehicle that you had no idea how in the world you would get a hold of it, and suddenly it's parked in your driveway. And I'm not talking about deep in debt. I'm talking about no way for you to be able to have that, or a home that you're living in. Doctors have given you the worst report. But whenever the report comes back, we know what the report of the Lord says. I have a great pastor friend back in Texas, and my nephew is married to his daughter. And the report of the Lord, of the doctors were this, we're going to operate on this, but there's no way we can get it all, and everyone that has this type of cancer, they die. But God. And on the way here, as I was flying, just as I got ready to push the button that puts it on airplane mode, I get the text from my nephew's wife that says, the tumor, the cancer is dead. It's drying up. There's absolutely no activity at all. But God.
Thank you, Lord.
Opportunities for you to give testimony
right.
of the goodness of God.
Amen. Amen.
To create an atmosphere.
Yeah.
Because their walls are falling in. Everything around them is shaking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But God is in the midst of performing suddenlies.
Amen. Amen.
Making things happen.
Yes.
And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. And then he took them the same hour that night, washed their stripes, and the family was baptized, he and all of his house straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them, probably was Wagyu, and they rejoiced, believing in God with all of his house. Praise until something happens. What is praise? Well, this is a praising church, but can I just bring it down to a very simple thing? Praise is having a grateful heart. Let me tell you something. Everyone in this room, I don't care who you are, you can have a grateful heart. You can thank God for something. You can thank God you didn't walk down those stairs today buck naked. Bad sight if you're 63 years old. Not a pretty sight. But we have so much to be thankful for. Praise. Praise. Praise in its purest form is having a grateful heart, a thankful heart. Praise puts our focus on the goodness of God. Listen, get your eyes off of CNN and Fox Network and anything else. I just turn it off. Put something on that changes the atmosphere of your house, of where you are. You have a smartphone. You have a computer in your hand that has every praise song in the book on YouTube. We have no excuse. Praise. It puts our focus on the goodness of God, the bigness of God. What the word has to say about God. Oh, my heart, oh God, is fixed upon you. Sometimes the only thing to do is praise. Otherwise, you'll cuss. Unless you're a good Christian. Come on. Some people, the only time they use the name of Jesus is when they use it in vain. You know, I talked about this a while ago. Start your day just by speaking the name. There'd been a time or two I was in a hotel and I went, Jesus! And they could hear me all the way down the hall because I needed to shout it. I didn't need a little Jesus. I needed to shout Jesus because what I was facing was not good. I needed a change of atmosphere. You know, preachers have struggles too. There are times whenever we want to quit. Not very often, but every now and then we want to go, Lord, is this really worth it? I just want to go to Portland and live in the mountains somewhere. Just let them have it. But we can't. We have to come back and we have to share the gospel and we have to do what God's called us to do. But there are times whenever I just want to say, what the use? Praise. It's okay to say, Lord, I don't get it. I don't understand. Some of these things that are happening, I don't understand why this is happening. It's okay to say that. But then you have to back it up with, but Lord, you say, I can do all things through you. I'm the head and not the tail. I'm above and not beneath. Praise. You see, when things get dark, and they will get dark, and trials come, and these opportunities to curse God and walk away, you must know how to stand. You must know how to fight. You need the word of God upon your lips and in your heart so that whenever you speak it, the enemy knows what you're saying and from whence you say it. Praise. Praise until, I love this, until what? Until the thing you're believing God for is made manifest, or that situation you're standing in, it changes. We stand. Until we see the manifestation of the goodness of God and the presence of God in that situation, we stand. Ephesians chapter 6, we put on that helmet of salvation, that breastplate of righteousness, that belt of truth, that shield of the Spirit, the sword of the Spirit, those shoes, the preparation of the gospel of peace. We have to know how to stand. Praise until. Thing about praise is this. Praise is a little bit different than meditation. We can meditate, and it is. We can meditate upon the goodness of God, but praise has a voice. Praise has a voice. We're coming to church today. Guys were driving by us with their flags on the side with the, you know, the lightning bolt down the side, and then and then there's another one, his flag, and he's got the Bronco on the side. You know, they're guys that are making their voice known today. They're going to paint their face one half one color and one half the other, and most people will go to church.
It's true. It's true.
The enemy, if I can just shut their mouth, I've won the victory. Praise has a voice. Praise has a voice. Until whatever you're believing God for or whatever God has promised you comes to pass. Until the atmosphere of that situation that you're standing in, that atmosphere changes. And the best way to make the atmosphere different is for you to open your mouth and you begin to declare the goodness of God.
Right.
I speak those things that be not as though they are. You see, you don't have to be a singer. A lot of people think praise is all about singing. No, it can be. But praise is not necessarily a song. It's an attitude of the heart. Praise is an attitude of the heart. You pray whenever you're standing, you praise your way to your place of victory. You continue to praise. You continue to stand. Not complaining, not griping, but in total trust that God has that situation under control. Hallelujah. Activating his angels to have charge over that situation. Activate them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, I love this. Good stuff. Let me move on. Praise until something. Something. What is something? Well, it's not nothing. Do you know most believers do nothing? Most believers don't even go to church anymore. The average churchgoer in America makes it maybe twice a month. So basically, I know the abiding place is not that way here, but most pastors have two congregations. They do. They only show up twice a month. Sad. And we wonder why the atmosphere of our country. We have more mega churches than we ever have had.
Come on.
But the atmosphere of our country is worse than it's been ever that I know of in my lifetime anyway. Why? Most people do nothing. Something is not nothing. Whenever you do nothing, basically what you're saying is this: my situation will never change. The marriage, the business, my spiritual life, my situation, my finances, whatever, it'll never change. That's why the divorce rate is where it is. They don't believe their marriage can ever be redeemed. That's why people walk away from a business and declare bankruptcy, is because this is never going to change. That's why people commit suicide. It's because they don't believe their life can ever change. They lose hope. They're hopeless. When He is our blessed hope. He's our blessed hope. The Bible says in James chapter 1, be a doer of the word. We're to be doers of the word. And the first thing that a believer needs to learn to do is whenever he reads the word, allow that word to drop in his spirit. And as that word drops in his spirit, there should be something that comes forth from you, a grateful heart for what that word has to say. It's life-changing. And there's a demonstration of that word that's on the inside of us, which is an act of praise and thanksgiving, which in turn gets the attention of Almighty God, which pours out His Spirit upon us, which causes hunger to go back to the Word. And as the Word comes alive, we give our thanks unto God with a grateful heart. And as we do, and we open our mouth and praise Him, the atmosphere changes. His presence is here, which causes hunger to go back to the Word. It's not rocket science. But there's something about a worshiping, praising church that knows how to stand and continue to declare the goodness of God. When things are not pretty, when they don't feel like it's ever going to change, but then suddenly, in your midnight hour, things begin to shake and God begins to move things supernaturally. No way in the natural it should ever happen. But suddenly, something begins to happen. Now, this is what I love about this. The first three are our part. Praise until something. That's my part. But the fourth part is God's part. Now, I can't make Him move, but I tell you what I can do. I can put myself in a position to watch Him move. And I know as I put myself in that position that He wants to move, because my praise, my faith, my hope, it pleases Him. It gets His attention. How many of you are fathers here today? How many grandfathers we have here today? Not as many. But let me tell you something. My grandbabies, all they have to do is the first thing they do, every one of them, the first thing they do when they see me and the door opens, they holler, "Puppy!" And they come running. You know why? Because anything I have, they know is theirs. Anything. One of my grandsons, because I don't get to see him very often, he knows that sometime in our visit, we're going to go to Target. And it might only be a $3 matchbox car. But Poppy and Aiden are going to Target. Why? Because he knows that I love him. And I know that he loves me. And he's not done anything to hurt me. He has an attitude every now and then, but we have our ways of saying, "Now listen, let me tell you something. The quickest way for us to avoid our trip to Target is for you to have a bad attitude. We're going to love mommy, and we're going to love daddy, and we're going to have a sweet attitude. Because if we don't, we just might not go to Target this time. Our Heavenly Father has all heaven at our disposal. And He loves us. And He is ready. And His suddenlies are available to everyone. All He's asking from us is that we praise Him. And we stand in the midst of the trials, and we don't succumb to all the pressure and the way the world operates and the way the world does things, but that we move past that and we stand in a higher plane, and we stand in faith and we declare what He says about every one of these situations. And in our midnight hour, oh yeah, when we think, well, this time it just might not happen, He says, I know it's the last moment, but I'm teaching, I'm trying to show you some things here. I'm helping you grow in the midst of this thing. You can do more in the midst of these things than you think you can. I'm here. I'm not going to allow these things to hurt you or harm you. I've got your back. I'm covering you. No evil, no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. I got you. You just got to understand, he's got us. He's not going to allow things to happen like that. We live in a fallen world, but we are still kingdom people. And the principles of the kingdom, they override anything of this realm. But the problem is most people, they stop short of God's way. We either get tired or we allow the thing, and we just give up. Praise until something happens. The happens part is God's part. It's His part. You can't make Him move, but He's ready to move. The word here happens to me means results. There are things that I can't do. There are things that there's no way in the natural realm they should happen. But as I walk in kingdom principle, and as I walk in the ways of God, His ways are past finding out. I go, God, how'd you do that? He says, I'm not telling all my secrets. That's where faith comes in. The world calls it a phenomenon, a coincidence. We call it revival. We call it suddenness. Whether it be salvation, deliverance, your family member healed, set free, marriages restored, businesses turned around, whatever it is. The world calls it the 12th man. They have all kinds of names for it. Mojo, they call it whatever. We know it's the supernatural. You can't tap it all. It's the power of God. A source that never runs dry.
Right. That's right.
And it doesn't matter what it is in your life that you're facing, what that situation is. Maybe it's a creative idea that God's given you and you're going, God, how in the world is this going to come to pass? Just like everyone else, whether they're sitting in their garage tinkering with a bunch of electronic equipment, and somehow or another they figure out a way to build a computer you can hold in your hand. Where do you think they got that idea?
Come on.
The devil's never had a creative idea in his life. He's a thief.
Yeah.
He steals from everybody else.
Yeah.
We open our big mouth, he goes, oh, I didn't think of that. I think I will. He's an angel. He's a created fallen angel. But we were created in the image of Almighty God.
Come on.
And God wants to give us His thought process. We have His thought process. Our Heavenly Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. When God shows up, when a suddenly takes place and happens. Not just a little bit of God is there.
Come on.
All of God is there.
Come on.
The same creative power
that
was at creation when God said, light be, is in that moment, in that suddenly for you.
That's right.
Whether it's a coin in the fish's mouth, whether it's multiplying your bread and flesh or your bread and oil or your meal and oil or whatever it is. Whatever it is, he's there. And everything, all of him is there.
That's right.
Praise activates our faith. Praise activates our faith, and faith activates the power of God. And thanksgiving should be our response.
Yes, that's right. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus.
I think somehow or another God hates arrogance. That's why all of us hate spoiled kids. Because there is an arrogance there. I deserve this. No, we deserve death. But because of the love of our Heavenly Father, and because he graced us to live in his family, then everything he has is mine.
Right.
And I'm going to be sure I'm going to be a good son.
Right.
And I'm going to be a grateful son. You see, that's the difference. You can get around people that they have this air about them. You know, I deserve this. Or even preachers. Some guys you get around, you just want to go, you make me sick to my stomach, man. You're nothing without the presence and the power of God. That arrogance will cause us to fall. But when we stand and we know who he is, there is a boldness and there is an authority that arises when you know who you are in Christ. That you can stand in places that others are afraid to go. And you know all the words and what everybody said about that area. Okay? I'll never will forget one story. I was in South Africa, and it was the end of a night. We wanted something to eat, and we were in a van. And we drove to a place where we got us some Nando's chicken. But we happened to end up at a Nando's in the middle of a very, very rough area. I didn't know I was in a rough area. I'm in a van. But so I get there, and I park. I walk over, make my order, and I come back and get in the van waiting on it because we're going to take it to go. A man in a Mercedes, a black man and his wife, drive up beside me, decked out, nice suit and everything. He got out of his S550 and he walked over to where I was standing and he went. Knocked on the window. And I rolled my window down about that far. Knocked and he said, "You're in the wrong place." I said, "What do you mean I'm in the wrong place?" He said, "You're not safe here. You need to go now." I said, "I'm waiting on my chicken." He said, "No, no, you need to go now." I said, "I will as soon as I get my chicken. I paid for my chicken. I'm away from my chicken." He said, "I'm just telling you, you're in a bad place." So he and his wife went and sat down right in front of my van at an outdoor little area there. They're having their, and they're ordering their chicken. And she sets her purse right on the ledge of the table. No sooner had she set her purse, and it was a Gucci or something. It was a fancy purse. She set it on the table. Then this 12-year-old boy snatched her purse and took off running. And this man, it was kind of like he went, looked at me, and he just took off running for this kid. And about four of the men took off running for him. 20 minutes went by. I was sitting there waiting. I said, "I'm going to watch this." My chicken came. I had it. And we were fixing to leave. And here comes this man. He had that 12-year-old boy by the scruff of the neck. And he set that boy down in that chair. And then he looked right straight because he had the purse in his, underneath his arm. And then he looked at me and he said, "I told you, you're in the wrong place." But sometimes you don't have any idea where you are. But the presence of the Lord covers us. Why? Because I'm his instrument. And because I've put myself in a position to where I have no reason to be afraid. Come on. I have no reason to be afraid. I haven't done something that would cause my Heavenly Father to say, "You know what? This is where you need to have a lesson taught. So I'm going to lift a little bit of my covering and I'm going to..." No. I don't know about you, but I want to walk in that authority and boldness, not with an arrogance of "look what I have" or "look who I am." I mean, there's been enough happen in my lifetime and through my family and my heritage to where I could say, yeah. I've got the things on my mantle to prove we've done a few things. But you know what? They are slowly tarnishing. They're slowly tarnishing. And people look at that and they go, that's a funny looking. Where'd you get that? Well, back in 1980, Dove Awards, Album of the Year. It's tarnishing. Can't even hardly read it anymore because the glue that held the little plaque on the front of it now is eat through the thing and you can't even read it. My chains are gone. I've been set free. What are you doing about what's happening around you and in your life? Are you allowing the enemy to push you around, or are you pushing back? I'm pushing back. I'm not allowing the enemy to steal anything that God has promised me. For somebody here today, you're just a praise away from your breakthrough. You've complained about it long enough. Well, that's what my mom died from. That's what happened to my family. That's why I have. No. When you were born again, you received new DNA. The old things were cut off. And you received a blood transfusion from heaven itself. An everlasting covenant with God was made with you. For somebody here today, your breakthrough is just a praise away, just a shout away. Maybe you need to stand where you are and for the first time in your life say, this is it. I've got a line in the sand. I grew up in Texas. And they talk about the battle at the Alamo. And old Stephen F. Austin was laying on a cot. And he took his sword and he drew a line in the sand. And he said, if you're with me, he said, we're going to cross. He said, cross this line in the sand. And he said, we all commit that we're going to give our life for this place. And the history says that they all stepped across the line. And he was the one who had made the statement, but he was on a cot and he couldn't. He said, men, pick me up and put me across that line. For somebody here today, you've been back across the line waiting for God to do something. But you have to do something. God's done his part. He sits at the right hand of the Father and he says, it's done. And he intercedes and he prays. But our part is to take a step of faith and begin to apply and begin to walk in the power and the authority that God has given to us. And to tell the enemy, that's it. And whenever it gets a little overwhelming, I mean, Jesus! You know, our friend says all the time, you know, God's not deaf. No, he's not, but he's not nervous either. I mean, 50, 60,000 people will fill stadiums. In Texas, Jones World down there, it'll be 110,000 people fill that stadium. And they're not ashamed or afraid to shout. But God's people are afraid. Oh, they're going to think I'm a little crazy. I don't care anymore. Now I'm too old to even care. You know, I got enough white hair now. When I walk in, everybody says, yes, sir. I'm not kidding. It's like everybody goes, yes, sir. What do you mean, yes, sir? What? When the presence of the Lord fills the room, that should be our response. Yes, sir. Where do you want me? When you want me? How do you want me? If it's on my face, I'll get on my face. If it's flat on my back, I'll get on my back. If you want me to run, I'll run. In 2011, the Lord said, I'm going to carry you around the world one more time because there's a generation that has never heard the sound of heaven. That's why we have a school. It's not because it makes me any money. But there is a generation of young men and women that are hungry for the presence of God. And somebody
Someone has to prepare a place where they can come and they can grow. There has to be churches when you have to fight for a place to even meet because of heathens, where people can come and they can lift their hands and they can shout and they can praise. They can pray and they can get on their face. They can run the building if they want to. There's something about that glory of God when it shows up. Everything changes. I mean, I'm telling you, everything, even your heart, the way you see life. You know, hey, listen, we're going to leave here in a little while and go back to our houses and go back to the same house and probably look at the same bills and everything else. But I promise you, there's going to be a different way you approach the way you see everything. Because you're going to see it from heaven's perspective. That's why a pastor preaches like he does. That's why he writes books, is he wants you to see heaven's perspective the way it's never been presented before. There is a generation that they have not compromised. They have not compromised. And you need to hang around people like that. Because the world will tell you, well, just don't get quite that excited about it. It'll be all right. That'll pass. Okay. We've had enough people say that for my generation to where we almost, to this point, don't have a country anymore. I still love to salute the flag with all of its problems. I still love to stand and declare and say my anthem. I still love to sing it because it's still a great place to live. Because we still can say in God we trust. Praise until something happens. Don't give up. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm not giving up. I'm just getting warmed up. I'm not cooling down for anybody. People ask us all the time, how do you get back on the plane and do it one more time? I said, because I have a mandate from God. Just have a mandate. You know, people ask me all the time, how do you know you're called? This is what I tell them, when you'll do it for free. Now, my Heavenly Father provides. He's a good God. He is a faithful God. And He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Okay? But you know what? There is a laying down of your life. There's a laying down of your life. To be a part of the kingdom of God, you're going to have to lay down your life. There will come a break in your life to where you don't care anymore what people say, what they think. And if that day has not come, it will come. Because that's how you know that God's called you to do what you're called to do. Because at that point, you don't care anymore. It's not about the money. It's not about any of that. It's about what God has put in your heart to do. And you will do it for free. Because somewhere along the way, He'll require that of you. You know, just so that He can show you that He's God and He can care for you. Tonight, I'll give you a testimony just this past year of what God did on our way headed to Asia for the second time this past year. And it was so God, so suddenly, it was amazing. And I want to encourage you. But maybe there's someone here today, just before we go home. You didn't come in the invitation a while ago, whatever. But you'd be here, and maybe you can't come back tonight. Maybe you're not able to come back, and I'm not putting any condemnation on anybody. You need to come back, but if you can't. But you'd say, Brother Joe, I need a suddenly in my life so bad. And it can be a myriad of things. But you'd say, Pastor Joe, I need a suddenly. I need God to show up in this thing so bad. But here's what He requires. Is first of all, we have to learn how to repent. We have to learn how to say, Lord, if I've not handled this situation right, if I overstep my boundaries in an area, Lord, I ask You to forgive me. If you knew how many times I told my wife, honey, I'm so sorry. And it wasn't because I was necessarily wrong.
But you know what? I didn't want to let there be anything stand in the way. Because even if she thought that I was wrong in that situation, I would rather go to her and say, honey, I am so sorry that I've offended you. You know why? Because we flow together as one. And for us to do what we're called to do together, you cannot be at odds with each other. You just can't do it. And so you have to have that intimacy. You have to have that relationship. And there has to be a quick response. Lord, I'm so sorry. Father, have I done anything? Because for me to do what you've called me to do and for there to be the favor of God on my life, there can't be any walls. So maybe you're here today and you'd say, Brother Joe, I need a suddenly so bad. You're not going to be able to be here tonight. I just want you to stand to your feet. We'll just pray for you before we go here in a minute. Or we might ought to turn it over to you and let you, because you need to receive the church's offering and all that good stuff before we go. But I'll just hang around. I'll pray for people if I need to before we go home today. But how many of you need some suddenlies in your life? You need God to do some big things. Look at these hands. I got both my hands up. Holding the microphone, both hands are up, and if I could defy gravity, I'd put both feet up. I promise you right now. I'm telling you right now. Because there's some things we're believing God for. I haven't seen the manifestation of that yet, but it's on the way. Maybe you're believing God for some of that, and you haven't, but it's on the way. Nothing else, just lift your hands and say, God, it's on the way. I know it's on the way. Just begin to praise Him and thank Him right now. It's on the way. Ramosekera, remasa bendo, rimende, silamaga lomosite, remosta, imananamo kilebesete, radevo saka, remanda lobasidede, rinosoko, raba lebo sotora. Yeah, just stand to your feet. Just stand to your feet. Begin to praise Him. Just stand to your feet and begin to praise Him. Stand to your feet and begin to praise Him. I see it by the Holy Ghost. I have it in my hand. Maybe it's a family restored. A son or a daughter coming back to the kingdom of God. Being born again. That business that you have. Turning around. We operate in God's economy. We're not held to this world economy. Maybe it's a bad report that you received over your body. Oh, kamasende, I'm healed of the Lord. Healed of the Lord. Mamo seradieste, rabande, by your stripes, I am healed. Lobare semande. Lord, that swelling is going down. That high blood pressure. It's coming back to normal. The blood sugar coming back to normal. Ramanda, that blockage is being removed today. Whatever it is. Lord, that thing that we need to take care of. Maybe it's taxes. Whatever it is. Lord, we thank you for a suddenly. Finances coming in. Oh, la masa de die. Supernaturally. Inheritances, whatever, however it needs to happen. That property selling, whatever needs to happen. Jesus, Jesus, new clients for the business. Suddenly, Lord, a corporation grabbing a hold of these things that we're doing and being turned around in an instant. For somebody in your business, all it takes is one client. One client could change you from struggling to having to struggle in another way to manufacture whatever it is you need to do quickly enough. God, let us see you. How big you are. Jesus. Come on, speak His name. Speak His name. Jesus. 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 Oh, la mama. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We love you. Lord, we yield to you this morning. Lord, that whatever stands in the way that doesn't belong, Lord, you remove it right now. Remove it right now. No hindrance. No hindrance. Oh, Kalama, just lift your hands one more time. Lord, we pray the peace of God over every family member, every person in this room. Lord, let there come a rest. You've got this. You've got this. Lord, it's in your might. My job is to praise you. My job is to give you thanks. Get your word in my heart. Oh, Kalaman, that I might not sin against you. Then, Lord, I'm going to stand. Lord, I'm going to learn how to fight. I'm going to use your word to speak those things that be not as though they are. Lord, I'm going to be a doer of the word. I'm going to find a place to serve in this house. I'm going to find a place to serve. I'm going to give of myself to the kingdom of God. Oh, to be a doer of the word. Lord, there are ushers that need to be in this place. Lord, there are children's workers that need to be here. Teachers of the word. Outreach directors. Lord, we can do something. Praisers, musicians being raised up in the house for multiple services, multiple campuses, whatever needs to happen. And then, Lord, we're going to expect the suddenlies of God on a daily basis. On a daily basis, the suddenlies of God. I don't want to go a week, 2 weeks, a month for a suddenly. God, we need some suddenlies every day. Show up. Things that I could not do. But God, you're gracious. And you move on our behalf. So Father, we thank you. Jesus. Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. You hear our cry. Lord, you tell us you'll give us the desires of our heart. Oh, Lamadi. Desires of our heart. The desires of our heart. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Lord, we thank you so much for your goodness, Father. Thank you, Father, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father, for your goodness. Lord, we praise you. Father, thank you for the anointing upon every person's life. Father, we thank you for the anointing being expressed through every soul in this building right now. Thank you, mighty God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Today, you decide that you're going to be exactly what God said you are. Today, you decide that you're going to believe that God feels about you just exactly as he described today. Now, if anybody's not really excited about those two things, then you need to respond to the altar call right now. If somehow you don't believe all those wonderful, glorious things that God said about his people applies to you, that means that you need to be born of the Spirit. You need to repent and come back. It's just that simple. So we're going to give you an opportunity. I'm right here. We're here. Joe and I hooked up the same Holy Ghost. We're just going to give everybody an opportunity. Get right with God so that you can be who God described. You can't be anything. You got to be the most exciting, joyful, blessed person on the face of the earth when you start believing what God said about you. And then when you believe that he feels towards you as he's described, that he loves us just like he loves Jesus, that Christ Jesus loves us just like he loves the Father. Come on. You're set. You're good. And out of that, we worship.
We don't worship Him by constraint, because we have to, out of some kind of necessity in order to please God. But we worship because that we're so accepted in the Beloved. And I want to give you an opportunity this morning to honor God with your substance. You want to be blessed? You want to be blessed? Then you've got to learn how to receive the blessing that's flowing from heaven like a like gushing rivers. Not some little trickle, some trickle that, you got to get to one spot on the earth to find this little trickle that comes. It's a flood. It's bigger than Noah's flood. His presence covers the earth like the water covers his provision, in other words, wherever his presence is. Come on. And there's no reason to be as though you were in a desert, in a wilderness place, when there's so much provision. All you and I have to do is just begin to respond to Him. And in the response, to participate, just to say yes, to respond. Ha, kato yama. You call and He answers. Hallelujah. You speak out, and listen to this. Think about this. The Lord's looking through all Israel, and He says to them, they're standing there, they've been slaves for well over 200 years. And He says to them, I'll make you a nation above all other nations. I'm going to crown you with my glory, my honor. I'm going to dwell in your midst. You're going to be a treasured people, and unto me a holy priesthood, royal nation. And they're all standing there looking at God. I'm going to give you an inheritance that supersedes anything that anybody's ever had. And they're just standing there looking at Him. And so the Lord says, listen to me. I'm doing this for you. And He says, my word is right there in your mouth, in your heart, so that you can do what with it? So that you can do it. You can do all this stuff that I described that you can do. That you can be all these things that I've declared that you are, because I made you. Today, if we could just recognize that we could do nothing without Him, and that His presence is always flooding our soul, we baptize in divine power and glory. You know how quickly you get baptized in divine power and glory? As quick as you can recognize it. God has never moved in my life while I'm standing there complaining, upset, wondering. What's wrong? But as we just stand there and thank Him, stand and praise Him. And so today, when you come to worship, tonight we're going to receive an offering for Joe and Becky, because we love them so much. They're God's servants. We want to bless them. We want to be a part of what God's doing in their life. We just want to bless them. We want to bless them and honor them for their consecration and their commitment to serve Jesus with their life. They're part of the priesthood, so to speak. And I know we don't leave anybody else out, but there's some people part of the priesthood, they don't do nothing. So we praise God for the people that are part of the priesthood, and they're going acting like it and doing it. Hallelujah. Whew. See, Pop's got a commanded blessing. And sometimes his commanded blessing demands that we trust him, even though it don't look like it's going to work out right. Okay? Even though it looks like there's some better alternatives. From the beginning, man failed. Adam failed in not trusting Father, because it looked like there was some other alternatives that is pretty interesting to pursue. God finally found a man many generations later, an Abraham. Whew. Praise God he found an Enoch. Praise God he found a Noah. But he found an Abraham that was willing to trust him absolutely without reservation. Now, God's no respecter of persons. What he did for Abraham, he'll do for you. And all we have to do is be willing to go all the way with him. Just trust him. And why would somebody says, well, I'm having to battle this fear and this concern and this worry. Well, we already helped you that already today, over and again. Amen. I disqualify all problems, therefore I have none. They disqualify. I don't talk about it. They disqualify. I have the solution. I have the provision. And I want everybody to grab a hold of that today and just recognize there are many times that there's things that it seems like it's not going where Father described that it's going, but be certain it is going exactly where he described, And as long as you remain faithful and you don't weary in well-doing, you're going to step into everything that he has. Just don't stop. Just don't stop. You cannot lose for winning if you don't stop. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. So you just come now and you worship the Lord. Worship him. Worship him with you. You don't have to. You don't have to come. Nobody's come. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus. Would you find a bunch of people around you and hug them and bless them? I was getting ready to start praising them. I figured we won't even get out of here for another hour if I do. We'll all get caught away in glory. Find a bunch of people and hug them. Tell them that you love them. You look at them and tell them that you love them and bless them in Jesus' name. And if there's anybody you might have a slight little bit of problem with them, go to them first. Hallelujah. Watch what God will do through it. He'll heal you and heal them, bless you and bless them. Just simple cooperation with his love, and you step into a greater glory of it. Quick, response to his financial strategy for your life. My goodness. He's going to open up floodgates for you, pour you out a blessing more than you can contain. He's promised it. He's not a liar. He's going to do it. Amen.